everyone, so it's Hearth and welcome back to my channel. So today's video is going to be all about Samhain, what it is and how you can celebrate it whether you are in the broom closet or out of the broom closet. So Samhain is my favorite Sabbat of the year. So to start off with, what is Samhain? Now, if you don't know anything about the Sabbat, you probably have never heard of Samhain. You'd probably better know this holiday as All Hallows Eve or Halloween. It falls on the 31st of October every single year, unlike some other Sabbats which vary per day depending on the year. Now, Samhain is the witch's new year. It is the start of the cycle, or the restart of the cycle of the Wheel of the Year. It is one of the eight Sabbats of the Wheel of the Year found in the Wiccan tradition. Now, a little bit of note here, not all pagans and witches celebrate Samhain, or any of the Sabbats. It is very much dependent on tradition. The Sabbats generally fall under the Wicca category, with some witches and some pagans also celebrating the holidays. It is the time when we accept that summer is coming to a close and it's the time for the dark period to start. It's about closure and rebirth, it's about the development of our work with the dark goddess, and it's about progressing forwards into the new year with a clean slate. So Samhain is also highly regarded for being one of the best times of the year to work with spirits and spiritual beings. Beltane is another really good time for this, but Samhain is the main time when the veil between the worlds is thinnest. So it's easier to communicate with spirits, it's easier to work with the fae, and it's easier to work with ancestors. And that's a really big thing at Samhain. It's about connecting to where we came from, respecting the dead, allowing them to pass over, and giving ourselves a clean sheet and a clean slate to move on into the rest of the year. So, now that I've gone into a little bit about what Samhain is, let's go into how you can celebrate it. Now, I've sort of split this list into things that you can do if you are in the broom closet and things that you can do if you are out of the broom closet. Now, of course, depending on your personal situation, you may find that you can do either or you can adjust either category to suit your requirements at the time, but I just thought I'd split them because I do get a lot of people saying, I don't know what to do because I'm still in the broom closet. I do have some things that you can do even if you are still in the broom closet. Now, if you guys watched my Mabon video, you'll notice that some of these things are almost identical because they are things that you can do for every single Sabbat, but some of them are definitely different. So, let's start with things you can do while you're in the broom closet. So the first thing that you can do, whether you're in the broom closet or out of the broom closet, is to reminisce on the year that's gone by so far. Look at all of the things that you've accomplished, all the things that you've done, and everything that you need to work on in the coming year. If you have a book of shadows, it's a really good idea to look through it and see the progress that you've made in your spiritual path, and that can be really useful when moving forwards. This can also be really useful to see your flaws, the things that you need to work on, because let's face it, everyone needs to work on something. No one is perfect. So Samhain is the ideal time to look at everything you've done and see all the amazing things that you can plan to do for the year ahead. So the next thing you can do, whether you're in the broom closet or out of the broom closet, is to dress for Samhain. And I do this by wearing the colours of Samhain. So traditionally, the colours are orange, brown and black. Now you can use these in combination with each other, you can wear them completely separate, you can wear like cute little pumpkin pins or just something that brings the colour of the season into your wardrobe. Now obviously I'm kind of in permanent Samhain mode because of my hair, but if you wanted to, you could go crazy and dye your hair a fun colour if you're allowed to do that, obviously. It's all about expressing yourself and expressing the season in what you're wearing and what you do. So if for you the only way you can do that is by wearing specific coloured clothes or specific coloured socks, that's something that you can definitely do, especially if you were in the broom closet. So a really good thing to do whether you're in the broom closet or out of it is to have a feast, to have food, be merry, have really good meals. Now, if you're in the broom closet, this can really be as simple as arranging with your family or your friends or whoever you live with and want to take part in this with, just invite them over for a meal, just to invite them over for a nice time with music and happiness and food, and that can be your Samhain celebration. Now you really can take this one step further and have a proper Samhain feast if you're able to. So a Samhain feast traditionally involves wine, mead, or cider. It contains either gamey meat or a nut roast if you're vegetarian or vegan like I am. It can also contain root vegetables. Things like pumpkin and squash are really good, but also things like carrots and parsnips are really, really great to have at Samhain. Other than that, dark bread, anything with oats in it, is really, really good for celebrating Samhain. So it's all about enjoying the food of the season. So nuts, berries, cider, mead, wine, anything that sort of matches the tone of the season is really, really good to have at a feast. And if you can do that while you're in the broom closet, even better. So another really interesting thing that you can do during Samhain, even if you're in the broom closet, is you can leave out candles in windows to help guide spirits. Now the belief in this is that the spirits, as the veil thins, can get lost and stranded before it closes again. So you might have spirits that come over or spirits that are still on this plane that need to move over to the next and they don't know how to get there. And people believe that if you leave white candles in your window, you can help guide the spirits across into the spirit world before the veil closes after Samhain. So if you are able to burn white candles, I would like put a white candle on a windowsill and just leave it to burn down during Samhain Eve. And that's a really nice way of just giving the spirits a little bit of guidance into the spirit world. And it's just a really sweet gesture because at this time of year at Samhain, spirits and spiritual entities are really prevalent in beliefs. And honestly, as someone who has had a lot of weird experiences with spirits at Samhain, I can say firsthand it is definitely a time of the year for spiritual interactions. So if you want to give them a little bit of a helping hand, a white candle in a window is a really, really nice idea. If you are limited in what you can do, you can even use an electric candle if you're not allowed to burn an actual physical candle. So a really great idea if you can. Now, I know that not all broom closeted practitioners are able to do this or have the means to do this, but if you can, Sabbat divination is really, really good. I talked about this in my last video. If you guys didn't see that, Sabbat divination is essentially just divination that's done at the Sabbat for the next turn of the wheel of the year. So you would do divination from Samhain to Yule. So it'll give you like an idea of what could potentially happen between now and Yule. But Samhain is also a really, really good time to do year divination. So it is the start of the new year, it's the beginning of the wheel of the year again, and so it's a really great time to do full wheel of the year divination so you can see what's coming in your future for the next 12 months. Now you can do this with whatever means you like, you can do this with a pendulum. You do not need to buy a pendulum just needs to be a weight at the end of string, so you don't need to go super expensive if you want to do this but don't already have divination tools. You can do this with runes, Elder Firthark or Witch's runes, you can do this with oracle cards, tarot cards, tea leaves, whatever you want to do and whatever divination you feel comfortable with, do some yearly wheel of the year divination. They are so fun to do, especially on the evening of a Sabbat. So if you're interested in that, have a look at it, see what kind of divination method you would like to use and give it a go because honestly, it's really fun and it's just really great to set the mood for the Sabbat if on Samhain Eve you can, you know, lay out your runes or your tarot cards and do a reading. So that's a really good idea. Now I know that not all broom closeted practitioners are going to be able to do this, so if you can't, I'm really sorry, hopefully you'll be able to do it soon, but I thought I'd put this in this category because I do know a lot of broom closeted witches who do have divination tools and do use them. So from this point onwards, it's more of the things that you can do if you are out of the broom closet. Now lots of these things can be tailored for if you are still in the broom closet, so broom closeted practitioners, don't just shut the video off now. Honestly, some of these things can definitely be tailored to suit your requirements, they just aren't obviously broom closet ideas. So the first thing is to make protective autumn wreaths. Now this is such a nice idea. As I mentioned earlier, spirits are very, very prevalent at this time of year. With the veil being so thin, you find a lot of roaming spirits around, so I find it's always nice having a bit of extra protection. So you can buy autumn wreaths already pre-made, and these are really, really nice, but you can also make your own. Herbs like cinnamon on a wreath are really, really good for protection. So if at first it looks very mundane, it can also have magical properties as well. So you can make your home look very autumnal and beautiful, but you can also include protective herbs and spices in there that can help shield you and your home from rogue spiritual entities that may not be so friendly. So the next thing is probably the most obvious thing that you can do during Samhain if you are a witch or a pagan with an altar, is to alter your altar to match the Sabbat. Now, I love Samhain altars. My manifestation altar is currently covered in tiny pumpkins. I love Samhain, it's my favorite season. But this is a really, really good time to change your altar. It can keep you in the mindset of the changing of the seasons. So I know that a lot of people, especially if you live in a city, can often lose track of seasons. When there isn't that much greenery around, you can kind of lose track of where you are in the year. So if you change your altar before each Sabbat, it's a really nice way of keeping track of the seasons and the Sabbats in a way that maybe our ancestors didn't have to do, but that we can do to keep up with the changing of the seasons. So some really, really good things to put on a Sabbat altar are candles. Traditionally, candles in either orange, brown, or black. These can be whatever kind of candles you like. I typically use beeswax candles, but that's just me personally. So you can use like tea light candles, you can use scented votive candles, whatever you have. It's just important that you recognize that they are for the Sabbat. That's really the most important thing. So on a Samhain altar, you can also add dried autumnal leaves, seeds, dried berries, nuts, all of these things are really, really great. You can also put out crystals of protection or for ancestor work. So I find that bloodstone and petrified wood are really good at this time of year because they have a deep-rooted connection to ancestor work, bloodlines, relatives, all that kind of thing. So those two crystals are really, really good to have on your altar at this time of year. It's also a really good time to connect with the dark goddess, just like at Mabon. It's a really nice time to start working with that crone energy before we really get into the dark time of the year. This is sort of the start of her time. It is now her phase, and so it's really nice to be able to work with her. The last really good thing to put on an altar are skulls. Now, the most stereotypical Halloween thing, skulls. But actually, skulls have been used in paganism and magic for thousands of years, and they are particularly good at Samhain for ancestor work. So skulls, if you saw my last video on working the skull candles, you know a little bit about them. But skulls are typically used to work with the mind, but especially at Samhain, they are really good at connecting with ancestors. So because most skulls you can find at Halloween and in candle form and whatnot are sort of human skull shaped, they are really, really good for representing ancestors, representing the physical form of a spirit that's no longer with us. So skulls are really, really wonderful to have on altars. And that kind of moves us into the next sort of thing you can do at Samhain, and that is working with ancestors. Now, a lot of people set up ancestor altars. Now, these are really, really easy to set up if you're interested. I have probably more detail on ancestor altars in my altars video, but just a quick brief guide to them. An ancestor altar is a space that you set up to worship ancestors in whatever form you desire. So that can be recently deceased relatives. It could be ancient ancestors that you no longer know the names of, you just know that they existed. So a lot of people set up ancestor altars at Samhain. They can be just for Samhain, or they can be for the rest of the year and you just set them up at Samhain. That is completely up to you. But on an ancestor altar are items and photos that represent your ancestors. So if you want to work with recently deceased ancestors, you can put photographs, trinkets, items that belong to them on the altar and to light candles to represent them, to give appreciation for them, to recognize them at this time of year when the veil is at its thinnest. You can also do this for long distance relatives. So if you know that you have a Celtic heritage, you can put items of Celtic heritage on your altar and light candles for them there as well. So ancestor altars are really, really wonderful at this time of year. It's the ideal time because spirits can so easily cross back and forth between the spirit plane and our plane. So it's a really, really wonderful time for that. So along the lines of ancestor work and spirit work, it's also a really nice time to leave out feasts for the dead. Now this can be incorporated into your Samhain feast in that you would leave out an additional place setting with food and wine or mead or cider on it, and you leave it there as an offering to the spirits that come passing through. It's considered a sort of general gesture that a lot of people do on Samhain or Halloween or whatever you choose to call it, just to give thanks and to offer them your appreciation as they are passing through between worlds. So a lot of people do that. Another way to do it is on an ancestor altar, you leave offerings on there, often of wine. And another good thing would be to just leave out offerings on your altar for the intention of it being for spirits. So if you have, say, a deity altar, I wouldn't necessarily put it on a deity altar because everything that's put on them is typically for the deity. But if you have a general altar, you can leave out offerings for spirits there and specifically specify when you are laying them out that these are for the spirits that are passing through from this world to the next. We give thanks and offering, you know, something along those lines as you leave it out. And that's a really nice thing to do during Samhain. And the last thing is to work with cauldrons. Now, a lot of people might be slightly confused by this, but the mythology surrounding cauldrons is very much associated with Caridwen. Dark goddesses are frequently represented with cauldrons, and you often hear the myths of cauldrons being connected with inspiration. So you have the cauldron of inspiration and also of rebirth. So cauldrons are kind of the ideal thing to work with at this time of year because it is sort of a season of death and rebirth. So working with cauldrons is really, really wonderful, whether that is just burning some Samhain incense or even some incense connected with a Samhain deity. Using them to brew potions, just having them around, like having them on your altar, it's really, really good representation of Samhain. And even if you don't necessarily have sort of a proper cast iron cauldron, you can just use a bowl as representation. As long as you know it's representation of cauldron, that really is good enough. So anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I hope it was informative for you. Let me know what you guys thought in the comment section down below. So just like always, I will put more information and links to more information in the description box for you guys to check it out if you were interested in learning more about Samhain and how you can celebrate it, as well as things you can do with kids and stuff, because obviously I don't have kids, so I don't really know what I'd do for Samhain with children, but I'll put some links down there anyway if you guys are interested. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, feel free to like and subscribe to the channel. I would really, 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 really appreciate it. So if you guys have any questions, comments, concerns, or topics you would like me to discuss in future videos, please put them down in the comment section down below. I am slowly working my way through the video requests. If you have asked me a question and I haven't responded to you yet via comment, it's probably because I'm going to be doing you a video on it. And if it hasn't come out yet, I promise you I'm working on it. I'm slowly working my way through the comment requests. I'm getting there, slowly, I promise. So anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed this video and I will see you next Saturday at 6 o'clock. Bye!